Hi, my name is Erin Bertoli, and I'm a Board Certified Behavior Analyst with Brett DiNovi and Associates. Please check out our channel for previous content that has been published on stimulus equivalence, which nicely reviews the concepts of reflexivity, symmetry, and transitivity. In this video, I will review equivalence-based instruction, or EBI, and its potential promise for our field. This area covers the task list items B10, define and provide examples of stimulus control, B15, define and provide examples of derived stimulus relations, G10, teach simple and conditional discriminations, G12, use equivalence-based instruction, and G21, use procedures to promote stimulus and response generalization. Stimulus equivalence is nothing new in our field. It dates back to the work of Sidman in the 70s, and put very simply, is a behavior analytic approach to symbolic function. A common example is used with matching to sample procedures, where we teach necessary baseline skills that are then tested for emergent or untrained ones. After teaching two interrelated conditional discriminations, test trials are administered where there are no consequences for responding, which tests for emergent or derived relational responding. We can test for stimulus reflexivity, which is generalization across all training stimuli, symmetry, which is reversibility, or sample and comparison functions, or transitivity, relations between stimuli that were never presented together during training, but that share a trained relation with a nodal stimulus. But this is just a small piece of the utility of EBI. In chapter 19 of the third edition of the Cooper, Heron, and Hayward Applied Behavior Analysis textbook, Carol Pilgrim speaks of stimulus equivalence as the holy grail of applied outcomes, establishing extensive, varied, and flexible repertoires with only a modicum of direct training. Behavior analytic research on stimulus equivalence explores how a person's experience with the environment establishes or changes the function of symbols, that is, their ability to impact our behavior or their meaning. This research helps us understand more about human behavior and how instruction can be designed and delivered to maximize learning outcomes. There are several key outcomes to EBI, which include class formation, delayed emergence, class expansion and merger, transfer of function, and contextual control. We'll start with class formation. Class formation is essentially the defining criteria for equivalence. Class formation occurs when strong and stable class-consistent responding on reflexivity, symmetry, and transitivity is demonstrated in the absence of reinforcement. With some learners, equivalence outcomes can be observed on the first probe, whereas others emerge as testing continues, known as delayed emergence. Because EBI is supposed to provide a basis for generating truly functional repertoires, class size becomes an issue. The minimum number of members to demonstrate all equivalence properties is 3. Spoken word, written word, and picture. But as class size increases, the number of generative responses also increases. And outcomes known as class expansion and merger have been studied, providing evidence that classes can be increased to include an unlimited number of members. In class expansion, a new member is added by teaching a new conditional discrimination, and is verified by emergent relations between the novel stimulus and of the established class members. Pilgrim, in 2019, reviews transfer of function by asking, what if the new function, that is, a stimulus control effect other than that of the sample or comparison in a match to sample task, was taught for one member of an equivalence class? If the stimuli that compose a given class are truly equivalent, it would follow that the new function should be shared by all members of the class. In other words, teaching a new function for one member of an established equivalence class would result in the same function holding for all class members. She also explains how an essential characteristic of many everyday classes or categories is that class comparison can shift depending on the context, contextual control. She gives an example of how the events that may be included in a class of good plays would be altered considerably if conversation changed from sports to theater, or how a list of musicians would be sorted differently depending on whether one was asked the musical genre, time period, or nationality. In other words, the very same stimuli can be members of different response classes depending on the context. Contextual control training requires a 5-term contingency and allows for the same stimuli to be members of more than one equivalence class depending on the context. The outcomes of EBI are significant for a couple of different reasons. First, the concept of generativity, where multiple stimulus relations are generated after teaching only a small number, getting the most bang for your buck when teaching new skills to learners. You teach a little and get a lot. The second is the defining criteria for equivalence could potentially provide an operational definition of symbolic function, and therefore make it possible for us to conduct a behavioral analysis of more complex human behavior, such as emotion, health, creativity, and intelligence. This second outcome is most exciting to me. After all, wasn't Skinner's original mission for us to use the science to address complex human behavior? As a practitioner who is studying and implementing acceptance and commitment therapy, it provides us with a behavior analytic foundation of ACT, which I believe has radical implications for our field. Although there is no single method for successful EBI design, a lot of research has shown that there are some specific training and testing variables that may increase the generation of equivalence classes. The following table outlines the major decisions that can guide the planning for EBI. A substantial amount of research exists demonstrating the effectiveness of EBI in increasing skill acquisition with neurotypical adults. Albright and colleagues conducted a study in 2014 where EBI was used to teach four class members representing the functions of behaviors to graduate students. The classes represented behavior maintained by attention, class 1, escape, class 2, access to tangibles, class 3, and automatic reinforcement, class 4. Stimuli within each class consisted of a single textual label and multiple exemplars of textual descriptions, graphical representations, and clinical vignettes. EBI was conducted using custom computer software and a match-to-sample format. A pretest, train, post-test design conducted during a single session evaluated performances on computer MCS, written multiple choice, and oral tests. Scores improved from pretests to post-tests on all three tests for all students following EBI. However, the research is still somewhat limited on the application with individuals with autism. McClay and colleagues published a study in 2013 entitled The Formation of Equivalence Classes in Individuals with Autism Spectrum Disorder, a review of the literature. The authors reviewed 9 studies that empirically investigated the emergence of untaught equivalence relations among individuals with autism. The results demonstrated that while most individuals with ASD are able to form equivalence classes, the findings are variable. There are several examples in the literature in which untaught equivalence relations only emerged for some of the participants or under modified teaching and testing conditions. In view of the limited research in this area, the lack of replication of findings, and the lack of investigation into variables that may affect the formation of equivalence classes, the authors conclude by stating how further research is needed. Dixon and colleagues have been doing a lot of recent work on stimulus equivalence and its application via PEAK. Stay tuned for more content on that. Dixon, Belial, and Stanley in 2018 demonstrated a strong, significant relationship between derived relational responding and intelligence in individuals with autism by evaluating the degree to which participant results on the PEAK equivalence pre-assessment mediated the relationship between the PEAK direct training assessment and intelligence. Results support strong, positive correlations between both assessments and IQ. The authors conclude by stating how the findings correspond with relational frame theory, suggesting that derived responding can provide a behavioral interpretation of intelligent behavior, as well as Skinner's elementary operants. Ruth Ann Rayfield in 2011 published another study entitled Toward a Technology of Derived Stimulus Relations, an analysis of articles published in the Journal of Applied Behavior Analysis from 1992 to 2009. In this article, she speaks to the relevance and importance of the technology, yet references how at that time, in 2011, there were only 27 applied studies on derived stimulus relations published in JABA. In this article, she examined every study and classified each article according to 9 specific characteristics that she believed to be relevant to the further development of this teaching technology. She concludes by emphasizing how this technology needs to be further disseminated if the paradigm is to have the socially significant outcomes initially predicted. Both she and Carol Pilgrim in the third edition text of the Applied Behavior Analysis textbook reference applications of stimulus equivalence to the naming theory and relational frame theory. Rayfield referenced how both theories focus on a history of reinforcement for responding relationally with multiple exemplars before a more generalized form of relating emerges with novel stimuli in the absence of reinforcement. Thus, both theories suggest that relational skills should generalize to a wide range of stimuli and a wide range of tasks following instruction with multiple exemplars. I personally agree that this technology holds a wealth of promise, but needs to be further implemented and evaluated. I hope this video has sparked an excitement for you to either continue to utilize EBI or begin to use more EBI in your practice. It is also my hope that additional research is published, specifically in relation to RFT, PEAK, and ACT, three of my favorite technologies to date. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe below and stay tuned for further content on the application of EBI in modern ABA curricula, namely PEAK.